Hello, everyone. We're back for another session today on What Does the Bible Tell Us About Conspiracies? We're on session 21. It is Sunday, the 20th, I believe, of March 2022. Mm-hmm. Michael, welcome. Good to be with you.
Yeah, welcome, Brad. Thanks for spending the time with me on that in Germany on that sunny Sunday. And now it is the beginning of spring as well, so we are approaching actually a new year. And not what the world is telling you, what the Antichrist thinks to change times and seasons. And so in session 21, to make a long story short, I did a session in Germany, a short one, where I said that I'm so sick of all the things that it's coming in your way when we are looking for the truth, when it comes down especially to the assassination of Kennedy, because these people are also only looking at it from the worldly view of matters. And so I did just a small example of things, and I said I'm absolutely I don't see any reason to go in between the things, but we have to start. We have to start at the beginning and not to start from the end. So it does not make any sense to show you a cow's tail, but I would like to present the entire animal or the entire beast. Yeah? So I'm absolutely against any details because we have to start with a solid foundation. So the most idiot thing to do is, would you believe the controlled media? So there was no conspiracy and there is nothing to see. Please walk by. Yeah, so that makes absolutely no sense, because we know that the Warren Commission has presented a result which was clear from the beginning. And also I want, and on that session here, I won't start into how many shots and who did what and what happened there, because this is just for the world who wants to know how fast, how precise and how everything is connected. But you won't connect the dots when you start in the middle of the mess. Yeah? So this is all just for the people. The only interesting question of the people is, who shot JFK? You see, that is makes me very sad that people only remember Kennedy for being shot. Kennedy was a politician. He wanted to do something for his country, it seems. And people only remember Kennedy of being shot. I found that so sad, actually. But maybe that's also the purpose, to repeat many lies and false hints. Yeah, I really stumbled across so many things that I said that is hilariously funny. There were sounds of a gasoline lawnmower backfiring. That was what the people heard. You see that when we got into this, I said, can you even top that? Maybe there was also a UFO. And I found some. Yeah, so it is absolutely futile to go into every nitty-gritty, because everybody, it seems to me at the moment, is making money with Kennedy. Yeah, oh, I got something, I found a witness, I found this, I found that. Even the so-called professionals with Jim Mars, the plot that killed Kennedy, he says the great masses of people will more easily fall victims to a great lie than a small one, and he attributed that to Adolf Hitler. I highly doubt that Adolf Hitler have made that claim, and if he had, it was not of his origin, because I know that his book has not been written by himself,
yeah,
but by other people.
Ghostwriters, yes.
Yeah.
That's what I've heard too, Michael, and I can verify that that would be the case. Adolf Hitler was not that intelligent, actually.
No, absolutely not. And you see that it's just another puppet or actor or so, that people really thought that, oh yeah, the more someone can yell, the more responsible or the more serious he is. And Adolf Hitler, this book has been written by Bernhard Stempfle and being looked over by Rudolf Hess, the guy who flew with a plane from Germany to England, allegedly to find peace. But the thing is, though, that I have found another quote in the book called Hitler and I from Otto Strasser, which also depicts that Stempfle was more than, I can mention that book here, Otto Strasser, Hitler and I, you can look that up. Yeah, he has mentioned that Bernhard Stempfle was heavily involved in the writing of the book. And what that means, I think you can suggest and you can think of yourself. So he says, do not trust this book. That's found that very good. Do not trust his book. Do not believe government experts. Do not believe anybody. And that's what I want to ask you. Please don't believe me or us or anybody else. Please come to your own conclusions. And if we start that conclusion with the fundament, with the basement, with the foundation, so I think that we have a good chance to solve the riddle. And we will also quote the Bible frequently, I can tell you. So we're not going into any worldly documentary because they're only focusing on 20 seconds or 30 seconds, the last seconds in the life of JFK. And please don't trust people with strange pyramid pentagram lamps. You see that these people here, I know why I can't trust him. I know that he has died some years ago, but I cannot trust him because I have read that he is involved with somebody who is very, very, very deep related and a part of the assassination, who also was present on that day. So please be aware of the fact that many people have been put out in the spotlight to distract the people, to only focus on the thing that who instead of how. Yeah, of course it was a conspiracy. Yeah, that knows every 10-year-old knows it's a conspiracy. You see, that is the leech window. I think that Mr. Oswald had a hard time shooting and looking for a target in a window, which is then being equipped with that, and also firing through a tree. But that is not what the Warren Commission will tell you. So we're not going into this because everybody knows that if there is somebody showing up with an umbrella on a sunny day, that could mean something. And if then the shots or what else is falling immediately after that, you see that every 10-year-old can conclude that there must be a part of a conspiracy. How hard can it be? How hard can it be? So I'm not going to every nitty-gritty because, yes, there has been people shown with the radio-controlling devices or radio and walkie-talkies, and so a thing which only was restricted in 1960 to military personnel, and it was, of course, also very expensive. But everything that was very strange happened in the last 30 seconds in the killing of Kennedy. Yeah, sure, people with umbrellas, yeah. And if you go into nitty-gritty, for example, here, the groundkeeper, yeah, Emmett Hudson, yeah, in the testimony, you see that we are busy with 1,555 sessions of Kennedy, and I don't want to go into that because you don't know if that is the right script, if that is the right testimony. You don't know if that guy is telling the truth. You don't know if that guy has been influenced. You don't know if he is lying on purpose, and you don't know if he has been threatened maybe to make a false statement. So what's the deal with it? We do not go into these entire testimonies if not absolutely necessary. I know that there was smoke. Yeah, or I don't know. Actually, I don't know anything. I don't know nothing because I simply have to believe all the pictures and all the testimonies and all the things. And we do not know how many stage actors there were on that day and how many pictures and movies are altered. And I would bet that every movie and almost every picture has been modified. They had enough time and resources and money to do so. So I highly doubt that if there were yellow marks on the curb, and I have seen that in Zapruder Z355 for your interest. I'm really deep into that conspiracy here at the moment. I highly doubt that Mr. Oswald had the time and all the sources to coordinate all the things. But yeah. Of course, we will go into this when we are at the moment of the assassination, but we are not there already. Yeah. So we know that many things were strange. There were strange, strange artifacts and photographs in movies. There were very strange things. Mr. Oswald had a second passport on another name. That is all not by coincidence. Yeah. This is all on purpose. But it won't help you if you know that he was just watching the film War is Hell when he was being captured by the Dallas police. It won't help you at the moment. It won't help you. We have to start at the beginning. And as the files have not been published, as Mr. Donald Trump has falsely promised, have not been published yet and will not be published entirely, Yeah, so it makes no sense to believe anybody but your own common sense and the Bible, of course. And the Bible, of course.
Yeah, Michael, if you don't mind, I'll add that, you know, sometimes we as researchers make mistakes. And sometimes they're glaringly big mistakes. And if you, the listener, don't have any patience or any kind of grace with us, that's fine. You just move on. You find someone else to go listen to. But, you know, I guess everyone's got to take it at their own pace, Michael.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you see that the official story is BS. Everybody knows that who has a brain to think. Yeah, but that's not the deal. I think I can conclude why they are lying, why they are making it up, and why they are telling that story. But to approach that, we have to start at the beginning. And then I hope that the majority of people can think on their own why that had to happen, and what are the why they came up with that so-called lame excuse. That is all staged. That has all a special purpose. But I hope that we can find a bottom line, so that you can start your own research, and then you will rethink maybe, if you now think yet that you know how it went on, maybe there are some alterations, and I like to agree on the fact that everybody has his own speed and has his own methods, and so please do not start at the almost end of the assassination. We have to start at the beginning. Yeah, so therefore, I'm just clicking here and making you crazy because you cannot follow all the things. But at the moment, it's also not important to go into this because we have to start from the beginning. Remember that E. Howard Hunt, if he had something true, he says that the Jesuits form the greatest intelligence service in the world and always have. So if you assume that the CIA has been involved in the assassination of John F. Kennedy, then you have to assume that there are many faked documents. It is no absolutely problem for the...
Oh, yeah, Michael, I would almost say that before you start watching the conspiracy series that Michael is presenting to us, you should go to the playlist on my channel and check out Code Word Barbalon that both your Glissman and I started, and then Michael joined us later in the sessions. And check those out and get a good idea, a good firm foundation of what Jesuitism is, because it's very important, actually. And I think that it is beyond the scope of the average individual to look into things like this, because they just roll their eyes and you know, oh, I can't handle this. This is too much. This is too hard. No, it's not too hard. It's not mm-hmm. too much. It's very important, actually, because it explains a great deal of what's going on in the world today, Michael.
Yeah. And so this is for the advanced people who really want to know more about Kennedy and the religious ties to the assassination, and also during the time of his presidency. Yeah. But all the documentaries you see, they are just want to solve the riddle how he could be shot on an open road, and there are several possibilities, and we will go into most all of them. But the problem is that you see that there are so many things and on purpose, and so many documents have been altered, that you really have a hard time if you just try to solve anything within the thing. You have to step outside and then to look it from the bird's eye, and then to see and then to realize that everything has been set up. Yeah. So don't start with the cow's tail. You have to start with the eyes. You have to start, what is that, an animal? Is that the beast? Is that a man? What's that? So if he was one of the shooters or somebody else, is not important at the moment. Yeah, it's not important if it was Mr. Harrison, Mr. Lucien, or Sarti, or someone else. Yeah. You see, this is all just a waste of time, because you won't be any more clever than before. And I hope that we do not waste your time. Yeah, because now you are listening to a convicted murderer. Not of Kennedy. But he claimed, yeah, I murdered Kennedy, but he murdered also another guy, or at least another guy. So do you want to rely on somebody who is a paid killer? Or do you want to start with a biblical and with a reasonable foundation? And I chose for the second. I do not chose to go into any documentaries until absolutely necessary. Yeah. So this is the real start, 21. It's called Asterix and Obelix. And don't think for a second that I'm going to get crazy or lunatic or what else. What is Asterix and Obelix? I chose Asterix and Obelix to start with because it is, at least in Europe, it is a very, very famous comic book series, a French right. comic book series.
Right. And we in the States have never heard of it. I never, ever heard of it till you mentioned it, Michael.
Okay. This is a French comic designed in 1959. And you see that this Asterix is an alleged fighter of the of the Gaulish people. Yeah, remember Charles de Gaulle? Yeah, this is Celtica. This is Gallic county. This is in the middle of France, in Europe. And he's carrying in, he's a member of a tribe who are refusing and fighting the Roman Empire, which has possessed the entire country. But the only city who is fighting against is the city of Asterix and Obelix. So these are two elite guys. So Asterix is the clever one. Yeah, so you got an impression here. This has also been made a cinematic movie from when the as a star of Obelix was Gérard Depardieu. Yeah, Asterix and Obelix. So this is Asterix with the wings on his helmet. So he's like a Hermes or Mercury. Yeah, so he's a messenger from the gods. This is the dog Edifix, and this is Obelix. Huh? Obelix. So this is the big one or the fat one or what else. So this is the start of the session. You believe it or not. Asterix in America, or the Golden Hinkelstein, or Obelix is carrying a stone, but it's just not a regular stone. They say it is a Hinkelstein. Hinkelstein means a standing stone, a man here a lit, yeah, is a man-made upright stone, typically aged or dating from the European Middle Age bronze. So this is just an example here. So why should somebody carry a stone? Okay, more clues. Asterix in America and Asterix the Golden Hinkelstein. Yeah, so these are two just depictions of that famous, hilarious movie. And don't you think for a moment that there is nothing to it. This is a comic, the Italian version of Asterix in Italy. In the name of Julius Caesar and with general sponsorship from Lupus Garum, I, Bifidus, pronounce the great trans-Italic race open. And the member for the Empire of Rome is called Coronavirus. I will avoid to mention the entire name. Huh? That has been set up here in 2017. Of course, these kind of things were present also since 20 years in certain numbers. Yeah, but it's very strange, huh? It is very strange. It is very strange that this has been appeared only in the Italian form of Asterix and Obelix. Huh? Appeared this guy with the name of C...Iris. Huh? Very strange. Yeah, so it's almost like, how to say that, it's almost like The Simpsons with their predictions, huh? Mm-hmm. Like The Simpsons, right. Yeah? Here comes our favorite, straight from Rome, for the victories, the one that can tell the mask, etc. C, double, 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 Iris and his faithful Bacillus. Straight from Rome.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy, yeah.
Isn't oh, boy. That something?
Yeah. And there was also a movie, which I said earlier before, with Gérard Depardieu, speaking of Obelix. So why should somebody carry a stone, huh? I think if you have common sense, you already know what I'm going on or what I have in mind, huh? What I have in mind. So, Asterix and Obelix said after the so-called alleged Muslim attacks at the Bataclan discotheque, where about 80 people will be slain and killed to death, they said, "Vive la France," and I will defend France. Everybody knows that isn't France because of that very famous statue here. Eiffel Tower, yes. Yeah, and they will defend it at any cost. So Asterix and Obelix are part of the military. They will defend her Eiffel Tower for everything. So what is this Eiffel Tower is, of course, located in the main capital or in the capital city of France called Paris. Paris is from the Greek mythology, is the son of the Trojan king Priamos and mother Hecabe. Yeah, and so when he's trying to capture Helena, he is starting the Trojan War. So Paris has been named after a guy who started the Trojan War. Great, huh? There are also people claiming that it comes from the Egyptian heritage of Parisis, but you see that there are many, 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 many possibilities. So this is a depiction. Do you know from the beginning that Paris has been named after a Greek so-called hero? Yeah. And also the Swedish group ABBA has been made a song called Cassandra. Cassandra is a female prophet. And she warns about the falling of the city of Troy, but nobody is listening to her. And so that is Cassandra. So that many, many people are using Greek heritage or Greek goddesses, gods and goddesses. Yeah, vain idols. Yeah, everybody is going into. And that has also a reason. Yeah, that has a reason with ABBA, because a famous band member of ABBA, Björn Ulvaeus, the one who was proclaiming to get rid of cash money in Sweden, and he was the first one in the ABBA Museum in Stockholm, in the capital of Sweden, to get rid of cash money. You can only pay by card. So that means that these people are part of an agenda, believe it or not. And also Mr. Björn Ulvaeus was since his youth a member of a Greek letter society. So no wonder that he's coming up with Greek mythology. But we will proceed. So Paris' fate was about the Greek archer. So the Greek archer Philoctetes had the bow and the arrows of Heracles with the deadly poison of the Hydra of Lerna. Oh, guys, that's a snake. The snake who's eating men with the mythology. Yeah, so much about snakes eating men, huh? I could have also inserted here Alfa Romeo.
Yeah, I was going to say, where have we seen that before?
Yeah.
The family crest of the Alfa Romeo people.
Yeah. You won it, you got it, huh?
Aren't they based in Switzerland too?
No, they are based in Italy.
In Italy, okay. But they hang out in Switzerland, yeah.
Yeah, in Italy. So the snake eating the man, yes.
Right.
Yeah, of course, it's also very wealthy Italian families.
Yeah.
Yeah, so when snake are eating men, men have absolutely no problem to trust anybody who has a symbol of his profession depicting a snake around a star, huh? I got a much problem with that. And in the newer days of 2022, you should be aware of anybody who is depicting a snake. It's not for your benefit. Yeah. So Paris is the capital city of France, and as well as a mythological figure of the Greek mythology and so many more. Yeah. France. I know that is German now, sorry, but in France there was among the so-called Sun King, Ludwig the 14th, from the Edict of Fontainebleau, there was a harassment of Protestants, and therefore many, many Protestants flew over the sea to America, or Romerica. Yeah. So they wanted to get rid of all the Huguenots, that's the name of the French Protestants, and they have slain the Protestants. Yeah, and his by name, surname, Ludwig XIV, was the Sun King, Roy Soleil, or Ludwig the Great, Louis le Grand, or Louis the Great, of course. And he reigned for 72 years, and he was very much influenced by a pater, a père, François de la Lachaise. Yeah, and so he was the one who was influencing the Sun King. Mr. Lachaise was the confessor of Ludwig XIV, and after the Sun King confessed his sins to Pater de Lachaise, de Lachaise said, "That is such a great sin, I can't forgive you." And after the begging of the king, he asked, "Okay," he said, "Okay, I can forgive you under one condition: you have to retract the Edict of Nantes, 1684, to." And the protection of the Protestants or the Huguenots in France, and then began the slaying of the Protestants in France. You see, there was a Saint Bartholomew's Day massacre in August 1572. French Huguenots, Calvinist Protestants flooded to the Catholic stronghold of Paris to witness the royal wedding of the Princess Margaret of Valois to King Henry of Navarre. The political match intended to heal the French wars of religion that had plagued the country for 10 years, but it had the opposite effect. Decade of tensions between Catholics and Huguenots, or Protestants for that concern, exploded into a massacre of St. Bartholomew's Day, causing the waters of the Seine River to run red with blood. This is not usually being taught on the television. And okay, it might be 450 years ago, but nevertheless, this is real history here. Yeah, I wanted to make it quite sure that Paris with the Eiffel Tower and Asterix and Obelix has something to do with the assassination of Kennedy. And we will go that step by step, so that you really see that Paris is a very bloody capital city of France where something happened. The city was soon littered with corpses which lay there. They fell or were dragged through the streets to be thrown into the Seine, that is the river of Paris. Eyewitnesses described the river being choked with corpses and the water running red with blood. Large pits were dug in green spaces so the cadavers could be buried quickly. This is true history, so it seems. And of course, there were no photographs and movies, and so they had to picture that in that picture, so that you really see that there's something to it. There is much more to it. There are so many things. Also, during the reign of a so-called Sun King, what do you think? What kind of religion somebody has when it has been depicted the Sun King? Come on, it's not that hard.
Paganism.
Paganism. Yes. Yeah. So there are so many trials and assassinations and poison and all the things. It's really disgusting. Yeah, he had lovers all around, and these sexual things were the main reason that he could not be forgiven by his confessor, Pierre de Lachaise. Yeah, so that also another ruler who had problems with this ongoing sexuality. He had then big problems, and. Yeah, they had always maîtresses, which means the same as mistress, more or less. Yeah, and so it's disgusting to go in this, but let's go, let's face it. The real icon of Paris is the Eiffel Tower, supposed to be the Centennial Tower, to be really big. It's more than 1,000 feet high. 1,000 feet, the Eiffel Tower. That's a project of the Eiffel Tower. Great, huh? Everybody knows that all around the world. I think you can ask children in Indonesia or where else, and they will say, "Oh yeah, that's the Eiffel Tower. That's in France. It's a symbol. It has been constructed by Gustave Eiffel." Yeah, so that is the tower has been named after the architect or engineer Gustave Eiffel. Yeah. What about it? Well, it's really simple. It's really simple.
What has he got his hand on a pyramid for?
Yeah. That's
the same
funny
kind of structure, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Has the same motif. Interesting stuff, Michael.
Yeah, and you see, there was also a protest of the artists. They say, we as writers, painters, architects, etc., etc., we are protesting in the name of the French taste with all of our power against the erection of this unnecessary Eiffel Tower in the heart of our capital. Because of our common sense, we do not want this Tower of Babel.
Oh, wow. They called it the Tower of Babel.
Yeah, they called it the Tower of Babel in the 14th of February, 1887. Very yeah, that was got that what got me into thinking. I said, oh, why did they ask, name that? Oh, it's quite easy, because it was the highest architectural monument on the earth in 1889.
Oh.
Huh.
I see. Yes.
Yeah, you see, your Empire State Building, for example, has been erected in the 20th century, but this was also in the 19th century. Hmm? So that was the highest building in the world. Yeah, so if you would like to say that in other terms, one of the new world wonders or so. Yeah. Yeah. So that was the lightning of the Eiffel Tower in 1900. And I will skip that now, unless we hit something special. So this is a symbol for the so-called liberty of the French Republic, because everybody knows that is the symbol for France. In June 1940, an Austrian guy, which happened to be the German chancellor, or let's say dictator, Adolf Hitler, after the viewing of the Eiffel Tower with Karl Wolff, Hermann Giesler, Albert Speer and Arno Breker, yeah, and so then he was depicting himself here as the ruler now in France after the capitulation of France. Germany occupied France. German soldiers, this is official German Wikipedia, German soldiers received the order to step onto the highest point of that Eiffel Tower and then to fix a swastika flag, a flag with a swastika there, but because it was too big, yeah, she was flying away after a few hours, and later she was replaced with a smaller one. So much so for people who want to make it big. Huh? I found that very funny story. I think that serves as an example for megalomania. Hmm? A big flag of the German swastika. Great. And many people do not realize that the German swastika is nothing else but a sun symbol.
Right. Yeah?
Sun symbol once again. Paganism.
Yep.
Paganism. So let's move on. Since 1980, this is a cultural heritage of the UNESCO, of course, because the UNESCO only rewards pagan symbols, temples, idols, statues, gods, goddesses, etc., etc.
Yeah, by the way, we can thank Madame Blavatsky for that one, can't we? The swastika, yeah.
Up to my knowledge, it comes from the Indian thing.
Well, yeah, so, but I mean, wasn't it Madame Blavatsky that implemented that into her writings?
Yeah, and
her writings were influenced.
Symbol, yeah, absolutely spot on. Yeah, and this theosophy symbol. But the thing is that it's much more older than Madame Blavatsky, and also Madame Blavatsky is. She makes so many things up, and she said that she went to so many different places that there is absolutely no proof of. So she's a, yeah. What to say? What to say? So I want to make it short.
Well, this is all futile. And she mm-hmm. basically wasn't that true, Michael? That she was very influential in swaying the governments to look at it.
Yeah, so yeah, sure.
That's what I'm saying, you know.
Ah, okay. Yeah, Luciferian doctrine and all the things, yes.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
That's but all.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, there's so many unnecessary information here. It's unbelievable.
I mean, you know, occultism is just kind of the grassroots level of how things operate, isn't it? because
yeah, sure, you have to be a member of something to make it in this world. So you can also assume that Mr. Gustav Eiffel was not no ordinary constructor, architect, or whatsoever. Yeah, he had made a study of chemistry with a diploma, but then he had diplomacy and he had a very big talent of organizing things. So to have the most suited professionals for his project. And why is that? Because he's got several or some connections. What could that be? One of the things he did was not only to construct the Eiffel Tower, but also the inner fittings of the French Frédéric Auguste Bartholdi been constructed Statue of Liberty in New York City. Because actually your so-called Statue of Liberty has been constructed by French guys. And the inner structure of your Statue of Liberty has been made with the help of Gustav Eiffel. The Dictionary of the Franc-Maçon European is naming Eiffel as a member of a lodge of the Grand Orient of France without naming the lodge by name. Yeah. So there seem to be a financial support of the Freemasons to the Statue of Liberty. But of course, that has been debated. Huh? The Grand Orient of France with the one eye symbol. Is that not familiar with the backside of the $1 bill? The Grand Orient of France. We are talking about, of course, of Freemasons here. This is the Grand Orient of France. Does not look like YMCA, huh? This is quite the Premier League. Yeah, so this is the oldest Freemason lodge in Europe, which is, of course, in Paris, 47,000 members, yeah, with the accept right of Salomon. There comes also the allegiant legend of the building of the Solomon's temple. Mm-hmm. And of course, they always claim that has nothing to do with religion. No, that must be the case. But you can only tell that fairy tales to people who have not read Codeword Babylon, for example. Because we know that the Freemasons are honoring a supreme being. Who might that be? Yeah, and it's very interesting because if you go on into the history of Freemason, which we can also show here in English Wikipedia, at least I hope, history of Freemasonry in general in Wikipedia. Yeah. They say, of course, it comes from 1390 and also the things. And now you look at this. There it is. In German it is. In German it is, but really? Okay, then we have to get down the
it five reminds basic. Me of the French Constitution.
Like. Yeah, that is exactly what I was going on. The five
yes.
basic ideas of Freemasonry is liberty, equality, fraternity, tolerance, and humanity. And oh. where we do know liberty, equality, and fraternity.
Sounds like from. The Catholic Church to me.
It sounds like the French Republic to me. Yeah.
Yeah, what's
yeah if you go on and if we type liberty, égalité, fraternité, yeah. Yeah, liberty, equality, fraternity, French, of course. Yeah, for liberty, equality, fraternity is the national motto of France.
Yeah.
So France, French Revolution, allegedly takes the same basic idea, or three of the five basic ideals of Freemasonry. And now you have to think about that two French architects, engineers, Gustav Eiffel and Mr. Bartholdi, are then making, manufacturing, and transporting the Statue of Liberty from France to the United States of America. Of course, then the Statue of Liberty is, of course, a Freemason monument. That's my point. And that's why I started with friends. It's quite simple, actually. You can do your own research, but you will always see the same things going on. You will always see the same people, and they are connected among each other. Yeah, so you don't think that Mr. Eiffel was a regular guy. You can absolutely assume that he has something to do with Freemasonry. And now it gets really interesting, because in German, I found here a page of die Geschichte der Freimaurerei, so the history of Freemasonry. And it's not depicted in English. Okay, so we have to use the German Wikipedia. So the name of Freemason is most likely been derived from the stone masons or the freestone masons, but there are also rough stone masons. The term Freemason is found the first time in the Cathedral of Exeter in the year 1396. Yeah, 1396. And the name of Lodge has been named the first time in 1278, okay? The oldest Freemason lodge of the world is the Lodge of Edinburgh, Mary's Chapel. Nothing to do with Catholicism, huh? Mary's Chapel, in number one in Scotland. Her foundation is from the year 1599. Some theses assume that the Societas Jesu had created the Freemasonry at the end of the 17th century. Now, this is just assumption, but 1599 also is not the 17th century, but the 16th century. But in 1599, something else happened, and that was the publication of the Ratio Studiorum Dei Compagnia di Gesù. Yeah. And that's the thing. So then 1599 has been created the oldest lodge, 1599. But Freemasonry goes far back. Actually, it goes far back thousands of years ago. But officially, if you look it up on Wikipedia, they will tell you that Freemasonry has been founded in 1770. Mm-hmm. Interesting enough that in the German Wikipedia, what you won't find anywhere else, except in the book of Lenhoff, Olga Poser, Oskar Binder-Dieter, International Freemasonry Dictionary. Yeah, that is the book on page 433. I could not get a grasp on that book so far, but nevertheless, you find that on the German Wikipedia. And of course, after we have studied Cultural Babylon, we know that the Freemasons are just a cover organization for the Jesuits or for the Roman Catholic Church in general. Officially, in 1717 in England, four of the older lodges have been tossed together to the first Freemason Grand Lodge, the Grand Lodge of England. So this is the official foundation of the modern Freemasonry, 24th of June, 1770. Yeah, but it has been founded hundreds of years ago. And the idea of Freemasonry having a supreme being is far more older than that, and actually it's paganism. That's what it is. So you now got a connection between Freemasons, France, America, or the United States. Mm-hmm. But in the Eiffel Tower is not the only symbol, which is very interesting in the city of Paris, so the capital city of France. There is an eternal flame of, in French, a flamme de souvenir. In German, it would be the flame of remembrance, because in that Arc de Triomphe, there is also a tomb with the dead so-called soldiers in it. Yeah, so this is the Arc de Triomphe. Yeah? This is an Arc of Triumph. This is standing in the city of Paris. And when we were starting with Asterix and Obelix and the Muslim invasion and the so-called Muslim killing of These visitors of the concert in Bataclan discotheque in Paris in 2001, what was it? Bataclan massacre. Now this time not a Bartolomeo massacre, but a Bataclan massacre. So, what happened at the Bataclan? On Friday the 13th of November, Friday the 13th, three heavily armed gunmen go out in the concert hall discotheque of Bataclan. Less than 3 hours later, they were dead, having killed 90 people at the venue and critically injured many others. What happened in between? Bataclan attack. Yeah. And there are many, many, many disgusting pictures of it, and I'm glad that this article doesn't show anything. Yeah. But that happened in Bataclan. This, the French government then have decided to project so-called propaganda onto this Arc de Triomphe. Je suis Charlie. Yeah. I don't know if that is depicted here. I think I have to, yeah, Paris et Charlie, they really got, yeah, so. But in France, there was not only the assassination of these visitors of Bataclan, but also an assassination of writers of a comic strip magazine called Charlie, depicting comics of the prophet Muhammad of the Islamic religion. And so these people, or many people, were also killed in that bureau of that comic book production then. Paris et Charlie. Yeah, so Paris is Charlie. Yeah, so that was the assassination of Charlie Hebdo. That was the Charlie Hebdo massacre. Yeah. English, please. Yeah. Satirically weekly news magazine.
So much for satire, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, on 7 January 2015, two French Muslim brothers, allegedly, they stormed their way into the office of the French satirical weekly newspaper Charlie Hebdo in Paris. Armed with rifles and other weapons, they killed 12 people and injured 11 others. Yeah, so that's why they have depicted on that Arc de Triomphe, they have depicted then Paris et Charlie. Mm-hmm. So this is the Arc de Triomphe. Of course, this is another Freemason item. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's very strange that so many things in Paris are happening. So many killings in Saint-Bartholomew, Saint Bartholomew, what is it?
Saint Bartholomew's Day Massacre, is that what?
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, whoops.
Yeah. Oh.
and Charlie Hebdo and Bataclan and all the things coming on. And it's been named after Paris, who started or was the cause of the Trojan War, allegedly, of course. And yeah, but usually people think of Paris as the city of love. Problem is how to define love. You know, you cannot sail or sell love. So love is a very deep feeling of appreciation, actually. But what's love anyway? So that is depicted here. And usually the Eiffel Tower has been seen as a meeting place for couples. But they don't know what they are doing there. They don't know why, I think. Or a majority of people don't know why. They're just looking at the exoteric thing. Yes, it's more than 1,000 feet high, and yes, it's the signature of France. Yeah, but they don't get the point. You see, there are many signatures in France. For example, this guy, also in Paris, as you might see.
Oh yes.
Yeah, which was depicted here as Baphomet or as a devil or what else at the Cathedral of Our Lady. Our Lady is a little bit more.
Actually, isn't that a gargoyle?
Yeah, a gargoyle. Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, this Our Lady is called Notre Dame. Yeah, so the chapel or the Cathedral of Notre Dame. And so that was the place allegedly where in 1307, I think it was, where Jacques de Molay, the last chief of the Knight Templars, has been killed. And he wanted to see.
Yeah, Michael, there's actually a very tiny depiction of Baphomet on an arch in this so-called church.
Yeah, but I cannot. Yeah, but I don't know.
I found a picture of it some years ago. Did you know that it's in one of the arches?
Yeah, I could not find it, so that therefore I have to.
Yeah, today there's so much. There's so much suppression of this kind of information, and this was before that fire occurred at the church that we were. You know, Jörg Lisman and I were talking about it for a while, and I started looking it up, and wow, it's just this tiny little thing that you would miss. You wouldn't, you know, if you went to go visit there, you would have to look very hard to find it, I think. But the fact of the matter is, it is there, and yeah, it's quite something else that fire took place there some years ago.
In the heart of the chapel.
Yeah, that's right. Mm. While they were remodeling it, yeah.
Oh, there are so many things you could guess from that, but let's move on. You might think, what does it have to do with the assassination of your president and with Asterix and Obelix? And I would tell you. You see, there are two people, Asterix and Obelix, and also they have support from their sorcerer, a druid, of course, a Celtic priest, Miraculix, which is, of course, it's the same from miracle. Yeah, they have superhuman powers, etc., etc. And the names of Asterix and Obelix is coming from Asterix, means Greek asteris, means star, and obeliskos comes from obeliskos, means, of course, an obelisk. And that is what this Eiffel Tower actually is. It is a Freemason symbol combining of three separate symbols. On top, it is an obelisk. In the middle, it is a pyramid. And you see the arch here. Yeah. And so that's the same arch, more or less, here than the Arc de Triomphe, which is actually a sun symbol also, because the sun is then wandering here. But that's another for another thing. You see that two columns usually represent a temple. So if you know what it is, then you know that these are two pagan symbols here, because in the Bible, it is absolutely forbidden to erect any images or pillars.
So, Michael, you had mentioned just earlier that I don't have the correct pronunciation in French, the Arc of Triumph, that they put... the remains of soldiers in that?
Yes, of course. Yeah,
that's I necromancy. Did not know that. I learned
necromancy.
Something today.
Yeah,
I
necromancy.
Never knew
yes,
that.
Yeah. I cannot prove
no
it.
No wonder they're just... so important then, huh?
Yeah, and you have to drive through
these
that.
These are from Rome. They are not from France. I mean,
yeah,
France is using them, but they've been in Rome for thousands of years. So they were doing that back then, too.
Yeah, and so also the traffic has to pass through.
I learned something new today.
Yeah, so the passage has to pass through that arc, and also here the people can pass through the arc of the Eiffel Tower. What does that mean? Well, you see that in itself, the Eiffel Tower is a phallic symbol.
Yeah, they got a reflecting pool there.
And you got a reflecting pool there, and this is the female part.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you got here the phallus symbol, and here you got the uterus or the vaginal symbol of the woman. Yeah. And so yet if you compare that uterus here with the arc, both of Arc de Triomphe at the Ark, the basement, so to speak, from the Eiffel Tower, and you get male and female. So the obelisk, or the upper part of the Eiffel Tower, is more or less an obelisk or a pillar, and this is forbidden in the Bible because these are columns, these are pillars, meaning of sun worship or female, or male phallos worship. This is the obelisk of Luxor. This is the obelisk, which is an Egyptian obelisk on a St. Peter's Square. What does an Egyptian obelisk depicting a pagan sun worship religion doing on the Vatican? Can you imagine a Muslim temple depicting a Buddha? No, huh? I think you can't. So that also does represent that the Roman Catholic Church is a sun worship religion. That's what it means. It means the worship of at least Egyptian phallus symbol. And of course, there is also here on the bottom here, there is a so-called sundial. So regarding where the sun's position is, there falls a shadow. And so you can see it also as a sun clock or use it as it. Yeah, and so that is the inscription here of Caesar, the son of Divius, of the divine Gallius Julius Caesar, the divine Caesar. Caesar is the first one who used the label of Pontifex Maximus, which you can find in the Roman Catholic Church, Pontifex Maximus, regardless of the fact that now maybe Pope Francis said he want to get rid of the title, he won't use it anymore. But you see, this is here on the floor in the Vatican, Pontifex Maximus, yeah, with the two keys of the Vatican flag. Yeah, so the combination of material things with spiritual things. Yeah. So these are actually what that mean is they actually bear the same title as Caesar. Also, they got an obelisk there, allegedly from Egypt, but it has also an inscription here with Caesar Augustus, the son of the divine Gaius Julius Caesar. And that was the first Pontifex Maximus. So these are the successors of Caesar, of the Pontifex Maximus. Caesar's title was Pontifex Maximus, the great bridge builder between heaven and earth. Earth depicted by the silver key, heaven depicted by the golden key. And of course, the golden key is on top. Yeah. So that's always the same. If you know about symbology, you know that a line stands for Babylon, for example. The Line of Babylon is a German movie here. And you got the same symbol as the Eiffel Tower and the sea or the water reflection. You got it here in your American capital city, Washington. Named after the first president, George Washington. You got here a pillar and you got a reflection. You got the male part and you got the female part. And I don't know how many people who are gathered together here are totally aware of what that actually resembles. And make no mistake, we were no better. You see, the plans for the German world capital called Germania, if it would have taken place, if Germany would have ruled the world, and thank you very much, that did not happen. They also wanted to have a pillar there. So it's an eagle, of course. Oh, you see that is all the same symbolism. It all comes back to Rome. All roads lead to Rome. Yeah, and that's the same thing. And it gets even worse. Because on the field or on the area of the St. Peter Square, there once was a Circus Gaio et Neronis or Circus Vaticanus. Yeah? And guess what? Guess what? A more modern interpretation differs in various respects and maintains the central obelisk in the same position relative to the basilicas as in the accompanying plan, but rotates the entire circus around the obelisk. So the entire circus is around the phallus symbol. And it gets worse, because if that is the St. Peter Square, yeah, then that is where that circus was. And you can imagine what they did with the real Christians there. So don't come up with any accusations of being just by accident, happening just by accident. You see that the Vatican now is there where in the old times the Christians were killed for the fun, of course, of the elite. And you can figure out what the elite nowadays is. The Ten Commandments mention in a graven image. You shall not bow down to a graven image. And that is a graven image. This is an image of a pagan god. This is Leviticus also. Would you like to read?
Okay, I'll start again. Leviticus 26:1. Ye shall make you no idols, nor graven image, neither rear you up a standing image, neither shall ye set up an image of stone in your land to bow down to it. For I am the Lord your God.
Yeah. Yeah, so that is in the heart of the Vatican. And is in Habakkuk also graven image mentioned, and there are many, many, many more Bible quotes.
Mm-hmm. For what profiteth the graven image that the maker thereof hath graven it, the molten image and the teacher of lies that the maker of his work trusteth therein to make dumb idols?
Yeah, dumb idols. And Deuteronomy 16:22, it speaks of any image, regardless of which material they were built upon.
Neither shalt thou set thee up any image which the Lord thy God hateth.
Yeah, because these images are a depiction, of course, of any dumb idols. Because they cannot speak, they cannot listen, they cannot talk. They can't do anything, but people are admiring them. And in the German translation here, it's been depicted that it is Asherah image, yeah? Easter, Asherah. Yeah? Also Asherah is the same as
Here's one of my favorite, Michael, Bible verses that I found recently. It's Isaiah 45:20, and it reads, "Assemble yourselves and come, draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations. They have no knowledge that set up the wood of their graven image and pray unto a God that cannot save."
Hmm. Yeah, I did not insert that verse here.
No, I just thought I'd mention it because it's with graven images, you know.
Yeah, you think you get that point. You see that it's all pagan worship. And it's been disguised under the name of the Washington Monument. And this is here the Notre Dame, Our Lady. There's a sun wheel here disguised as being a Roman Catholic church. And you see the same arches here, like the Arc of Triumph or the Ark here, which is nearly the same as in the Ark in the lower regions of the Eiffel Tower. Yeah, and there had you got your fire in the midst of the temple.
Yeah,
there. Not in the outer things, but in the midst of. Mm-hmm. And so you see that every church tower is an obelisk, is a graven image. It's absolutely forbidden. So God does not live in houses made of stone anymore. We know that. But actually, this form actually depicts an obelisk. This is just by chance, some image I found for German churches.
Sure, they're everywhere. They're everywhere.
Yeah, it's the same. You see that even in Germany, in the capital city of Germany called Berlin, you see it's called Victoria, comes from victory. Yeah, so the so-called Roman goddess of liberty or of victory here, yeah, with the laurels, yeah, and a spear and a cross and an eagle. My. How hard can it be? Yeah, and that has been named the Column of Victory in the midst of Berlin. Yeah. Oh, it is not a temple. No, these are not pillars and this is no obelisk. Huh? And then a Roman god is on top of it. And this is the so-called love parade where they have made millions of people gather together listening to loud techno music and making love and what else and getting drunk and everything else. And people actually don't see the resemblance that they're actually worshipping pagan images and idols. And they don't care because actually, obviously, they are in the Antichrist spirit. I don't know what they are doing. And there was also a hymn, an anthem, "Let the Sun Shine in Your Heart," 1997. Anthem means A composition set to sacred music, a song of praise or gladness. Aha, you see, it has nothing to do with religion so far, huh? Yeah, has everything to do with religion. Yeah, and these people do not know what they are doing. Yeah, let the sun shine in. Yeah, of course, because it is a sun worship religion. You won't get millions of people going on for a demonstration for a reprint of the King James Bible, but you will get millions of people if you got free beer and free music and what else. Then you get the masses, yeah, on the Broadway. And it's very interesting because you see, this is the depiction here of the so-called Column of Victory with the Victoria, the Roman goddess in Berlin. Yeah, looks like Roman or Greek architecture anyway. Yeah, so, and these are coming from all directions, you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, northwest, east, south. And this is here a smearing of the street with paint, action from Greenpeace, to promote sun, for sun energy, solar energy. And people don't get it because, you see, this is a sun symbol also. They don't see that resemblance. They are not educated. You see, they are just in the exoteric. They are just working from 9 to 5 and they just want to have some fun on their spare time. You can blame them because they don't know what they are doing. And so this is just the same thing with the reflection. This is as above, so below. Yeah.
I think the Bible calls that being caught unaware.
Yeah. And even now, with the most serious pestilence of all times, yeah, you see, this is depicted here at the Washington Monument. Yeah, there are 650,000 white flags for symbolizing the deaths occurred in America. It is on that very area here, 650,000. Well, if there are more than 675,000 so-called victims, why are they depicting 650,000 white flags? It's quite simple. It's actually very simple if you know Freemasonry, because 6 plus 5 results in 11. And 11 being a very interesting number in Freemason. We will get to that in the next session. And also your actor Ronald Reagan, which was then a regular actor in the White House in the days of his at the day of his inauguration, that took place in front of the Washington Monument, of the obelisk, which is the same symbol, different size, but same symbol as on the St. Peter's Square. So you see that you're looking at the same symbol as the Pope. And Tom Frass did a session about that, and he said that that was a secret sign that now the United States has surrendered to Rome. And there is an alleged quote of Ronald Reagan, which he allegedly said to the Pope that, Holy Father, I give you my country, quote unquote. I have no quotation which I could verify at the moment, but I know that Tom Frass is using that quote quite recent. And so the Washington Monument, they absolutely admitted that it's a form of an obelisk. Yeah. This is also a reflecting pool, yes, for that very reason, because Mr. George Washington was a Freemason in the Fredericksburg Lodge number 1 in Virginia. Yeah, because the Bible was not ready. He has sworn his presidential oath on the Bible of the Lodge, of the St. Lodge number 1. So what do you expect when you got a Freemason, which is the first president of your country, swearing his oath on the Bible of Freemasons? Despite the fact that swearing an oath is unbiblical. But you see that the symbology simply is that the United States have been created by Freemasons. And more than that, because also Mr. Washington was a member of the Society of the Cincinnati, which leads us to one of the first sessions of that series. Yeah, that was Mr. Washington. And of course, they used the same symbology with the laurel and the Roman eagle all over the place. Direct in your face. First president of that order was George Washington. Yeah, so he was a member of Cincinnati. Cincinnatus meaning a Roman soldier. So what the purpose of Freemasonry but to bring the same doctrine of Rome under the disguise of Protestantism? It's always the same because they are using the same symbology. Yeah, you see, as the column that you saw earlier in Berlin, you see also it is about the four directions here, and you can use that shadow of the obelisk. There's a sun clock, a sundial. Yeah, and of course, all these people are Freemason. Yeah, this is the so-called creator of the Statue of Liberty. And I have received a comment of Eric Bowman on a German's session, and he said that there is a connection between Frederick Auguste Bartholdi to the Jesuits as well, which is absolutely clear, because the Jesuits are the founder of Freemasons. During the time of their repression, when the Jesuits were forbidden by a papal bull, okay, some claim it was not a bull, Dominic ad Redemptor, I think it was, Brad. They created the so-called Illuminati with a Jesuit priest called Adam Weishaupt. Yeah, in the same year, 1776.
Yeah, that's right, May 1st, 1776.
Yeah, and this Adam Weishaupt was, I think it was, he was just 24 years old or so. So yeah, all those people have big connections to the elite, yeah, which is the Roman Catholic hierarchy. Yeah. So they all have that famous hidden hand, of course. These all are Freemasons. So that is just a Protestant concept from the Jesuits, or in broader terms, a concept of the Roman Catholic Church. And this is your Statue of Liberty with the flame. Huh? Remember the eternal flame of the Arc de Triomphe? Yeah, it's always the same. Also, you got three windows here, Trinity. You got a statue, you got an idol, dump idol, and you've got, of course, the Statue of Liberty. So that should depict, and this is not your constitution. Yeah, it's always also not the Ten Commandments.
No.
And you see that I highly doubt also this is it's a female goddess, but that's just my... my idea of it. Yeah, and that should depict the Libertas, yeah, as also Roman goddess. So if your liberty is depending on a Roman goddess, what does that mean about your liberty? Now, we talked about that before. Yeah, and all Freemason stuff, 1884. Yeah, and that was the end of my German session, but of course I will show you that picture, because now you see that as above, so below, and male and female with reflection. Yeah, you see that it's the same as the Washington Monument. It's a little bit, the form is a little bit more extraordinary. Yeah, but that's it. That's it. It's a graven image. Nonetheless, it's a graven image. In every city, in so many cities, smaller cities, you see these obelisks. Yeah? Everywhere. So-called Egyptian obelisks. Yeah? Even in Buenos Aires in Argentina, you see that obelisk. Even in Köln, the colony. Köln means colony in Germany, a Roman colony, Roman Catholic colony. They allegedly have the remains of the so-called three holy kings, who never were three, who never were kings, and they were not holy in that regard. But you see that this is Roman Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also they have a few distance apart, they have an obelisk. Yeah. And that's what I want to go. I want to go into the roots of Freemasonry, because I say that the assassination of Kennedy was a ritual of Freemasons. Of course, they use the Freemasons to hide the real people behind. But let's face it, we will go further down below the rabbit hole. And that's it for me today. Because now to go into every detail or to go into the nitty-gritty of it all would be too soon. But in the next episode, we will go into, for example, into the festivities of Easter, Astarte. And from that on, we will go on to the location where the assassination took place in Texas, in Dallas. So thank you very much for having me, and God bless. And yeah, see you, hear you all next time. Thank you very much for your patience. And I'm handing it over to my beloved brother, Brett.
Thank you, Michael. Yes, learning a lot today in terms of European history. And, oh, you know, of course, Freemasonry is another topic all in of itself. And it's not that encouraging. It's rather disturbing, isn't it, when you discover that yeah, these Freemasons, they've been hanging out in my church for a while.
No, the problem is that you never were a free republic, but you were being founded on the basements of the Roman Catholic Church using Freemasonry as a cover. That's a problem. That's
a
real
huge problem. It's a huge problem, Michael. And that's something every one of us should consider very carefully. Yes, thank you very much for the research, Michael. And we'll be looking forward to seeing you next time, God willing. Maranatha.